Good morning and welcome, Friends Church. We're glad you're joined us today for worship, in person or online, and happy to have you here today. Have to apologize in advance if it seems a little bit cool in some parts and hotter in others. We're operating on just one less AC unit today. So you get to be the thermostat. If you're hot, move up three rows. If you're cold, move back three rows. Pastor Dave and Sonia are still on vacation, and from the Facebook post, it looks like they're having a great time. Much needed R&R for them so they can replug themselves back in and recoup and regenerate, recharge those batteries. This morning, Reverend Scott Martin is our guest minister. Reverend Martin recently retired as a pastor of Faith United Church of Christ in New Braunfels, where he served for 15 years. He's worshiped with us throughout the years and is no stranger to Freedom, so please help me welcome him this morning. For our announcements today, the next meeting of the Women's of Freedoms is August 12th at 2 p.m., and it'll be held in the Borman Room in the Activity Center. Mark your calendars to be here on Sunday, August 22nd. We'll have several special events happening, beginning with worship at 10 o'clock. At worship, we'll have the blessing of the backpacks, the students and the educators as they head back to school. Their 125th anniversary, we'll have a confirmation reunion as part of our festivities. The reunion will recognize all those who were confirmed at Freedoms. Following worship, we'll continue our celebration with a church picnic, and everyone's invited. This is a potluck picnic, so please bring something to share, side dish and dessert, and emphasis on dessert for Dave. Meat and beverages will be provided by the church. Confirmation class of 2021-22. Confirmation classes are for those in eighth grade and above. We'll begin fall 2021. Any information and registration meeting will be held for all students, parents, and guardians, Sunday, August 29th, 11:05 in the Activity Center. Any questions about that, please contact the pastors. And on a sadder note, Ann Borland passed away Friday after a battle with cancer. Services are planned for a later date, so let's please keep the family and friends in our prayers. And with that, please stand if you're able.
Let us join together in reading the statement of faith. We believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. We believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, Jesus rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. We believe in the Holy Spirit, one holy universal Christian church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Now let us join then in the praise song. What happened to the call to worship?
Hallelujah.
Trusting in God's forgiveness, let us in silence confess our failings and acknowledge our part in the pain of the world. And then let us respond. Before God, with the people of God, we confess to turning away from God in the ways we wound our lives, the lives of others, and the life of the world. May God forgive us, Christ renew us, and in the Spirit enable us to grow in love. Let the people say,
Amen.
Despite knowing our sin, God chooses to forgive us. Seeing our emptiness, God chooses to feed us. Holding our shattered hearts, God chooses to heal us. This is the good news. God loves us. God has graced us with mercy and created new life from our brokenness. Thanks be to God. Amen. come now to that moment when we celebrate the community of faith that is gathered here, as well as the community of faith that is joining with us on Zoom. We invite you at this time to pass the peace to one another by waving, bumping elbows, fists, doing the hokey pokey, whatever it takes. You're invited to pass the peace of Christ to one another.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you and also with you. And it's good to have all those who are Zooming in with us. The peace of Christ be with you at home as well, or wherever you are Zooming in from. You may be seated. Well, let us bow our heads for prayer. O Lord God, in whom we live and move and have our very being, it is good to gather together on this Sabbath Sunday to experience your presence in our midst, to experience the touch of the Holy Spirit through the songs and the prayers, the reading of Scripture, and in the silence. We pray, O God, that you would indeed be with us on this Sunday, that we might be receptive to your presence, which is all around us. We pray that, like those ancient Israelites, that we might be fed with the manna that comes from heaven. We pray that, like those early disciples, we would seek Jesus out and bring whatever questions we might have, but also be prepared to listen to the questions he puts to us. May this day indeed fill us with a sense of your peace that passes understanding. May it come to us through this worship service, and especially in the sacrament of Holy Communion that we will experience in just a little while. Be with us now, O God, as we pray together the prayer that your Son taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This time I invite you to stand to sing the offertory hymn.
Our offering is in the back in the box as you walk out of the narthex.
All right, I'll walk into the narthex.
You may be seated. We have two scripture passages today, one from the Old Testament and the other from the New Testament. The gospel passage references this one from the Old Testament, so they tie together rather nicely this morning. The Old Testament passage is from Exodus chapter 16, verses 2 to 4 and 9 to 15. The whole congregation of the Israelites complained against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. And the Israelites said to them, If only we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the flesh pots and ate our fill of bread, for you have brought us out into the wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger. Then the Lord said to Moses, I'm going to rain bread from heaven for you, and each day the people shall go out and gather enough for that day. In that way, I will test them, whether they will follow my instruction or not. And then Moses said to Aaron, say to the whole congregation of the Israelites, draw near to the Lord, for he has heard your complaining. And as Aaron spoke to the whole congregation of the Israelites, they looked towards the wilderness, and the glory of the Lord appeared in the cloud. And the Lord spoke to Moses and said, I have heard the complaining of the Israelites. Say to them, at twilight you shall eat meat, and in the morning you shall have your fill of bread, and then you will know that I am the Lord your God. Now in the evening the quails came. They covered the whole camp, and in the morning there was a layer of dew around the camp. And when the layer of dew lifted, there on the surface of the wilderness was a fine, flaky substance, as fine as the frost on the ground. And when the Israelites saw it, they said to one another, what is it? For they did not know what it was. And Moses said to them, it is the bread that the Lord has given to you to eat. And turning to the gospel passage, we find these words in the Gospel of John, the 6th chapter, verses 24 to 35. So when the crowd saw that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they themselves got into the boats and went to Capernaum. And when they found him on the other side of the lake, they said to him, Rabbi, when did you come here? And Jesus answered them, very truly I tell you, you are looking for me, not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which is the Son of Man will give you. For it is on him that God the Father has set his seal. And then they said to him, what must we do to perform the works of God? And Jesus answered them, this is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent. And so they said to him, what sign are you going to give us then, so that we may see it and believe you? What work are you performing? Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, for as it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat. And then Jesus said to them, very truly I tell you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread of heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. They said to him, sir, give us this bread always. And Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. Amen. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in God's sight this day. Well, these are two remarkable passages that we have from the Bible, one from the Old Testament with that familiar story of the giving of the manna in the desert to sustain the lives of the Israelites as they journeyed to the Promised Land. And then the passage from John that has the familiar reference of Jesus being the bread of life. Alice McKenzie, who is a theologian, makes a rather interesting comparison between the modern-day television show America's Got Talent. How many of you watch that show, just out of curiosity? I suspect a fair number of you. It's a very popular show. She compares that show to the passage from the Gospel of John. Now, I can't say that America's Got Talent is one of my favorite shows, but I have run across it when I've been channel surfing on the TV, and I've watched bits and pieces of it. It basically is a modern-day version of the old-fashioned talent show, the only difference perhaps being that there are a lot of more bells and whistles and a lot more high production values. And they also have those three celebrity judges that sit at their desk and they have a buzzer in front of them. If they don't like the act that's being performed, they hit that buzzer and you get that loud buzzing sound and the act is over. But even if they like the act, all three of those celebrity judges then will critique the act and tell the contestant what they must do to improve their act to go on to the next round. And they say things like this, even when they like the act. Up the ante. Make it bigger. Make it better. Make it more dangerous. Wow us more, or you won't go through to the next round. Wow us more, or you won't go through to the next round. Now, perhaps you're wondering, what does this television show have to do with the passage from the Gospel of John? Well, think of what Jesus is doing at the beginning of chapter 6. We didn't read it today, but it provides the background for that gospel reading. He fed the 5,000, story we all know very well. He fed the crowd of 5,000 with just 5 small loaves and 2 fishes. And the people all ate and they were satisfied. In fact, they had 12 baskets of food left over after the feeding of the 5,000. The crowd is so impressed, they want to make Jesus king of the whole country. Now, Jesus and his disciples slip away during the night. And so when the crowd wakes up the next morning, those who were still sleeping on the hillside, they look around for Jesus and the disciples, and they're not there. So the crowd gets into a boat, and they go to the nearby town of Capernaum, looking for Jesus and the disciples, and they find them. They find Jesus, and they say, "When did you come here?" Now, as often the case, we human beings get caught up in asking the wrong questions. All through the Bible, we find this is the case. Now, Jesus doesn't answer their question. Instead, he gets to the heart of the question, saying, "Very truly, I tell you that you are looking for me, not because you saw the miraculous signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For it is on him that God the Father has set his seal." Now it seems that even miraculously provided loaves and fishes don't last. The meal that they ate the night before, as with all meals, has worn off. Their stomachs are grumbling again the next morning. They're ready to eat breakfast. They're ready to eat again. And they seem to figure that if Jesus had fed them supper the night before, that Jesus can feed them breakfast the day after. He can do it again. But Jesus isn't about to become some kind of heavenly vending machine. He has bigger fish to fry, as it were. The multiplication of the loaves and the fishes, the feeding of the 5,000, was a sign of much greater things that were at work, that were at play in the world. God is at work in the world. Eternal life, kingdom living, is at work in the world all around us, right here and now. True in Jesus' day and true in our own day as well. As Jesus himself said during a time of testing at the beginning of his ministry, we human beings do not live by bread alone, but by the Spirit-infused Word of God, that same Word that called the whole of creation into being. That same Word that expressed itself in those days of creation that we read about in the book of Genesis. That same Word that is at work today, if only we will see it. Now, as usual, Jesus has a tough crowd to reach. We human beings are not always good at perceiving these things that Jesus is talking about. In fact, we go through much of our life not perceiving it. We human beings don't make it easy for him. And the crowd seems to ask a good question the next time around. It's much better than their first question. What must we do to perform the works of God? Now, that seems like a really good question. In fact, I'd love to have the answer to that question myself. But once again, Jesus seems to be wanting to go in a different direction. He says, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom God has sent." Now, that's the end of round one of Israel has prophets and messiahs. We're ready for round two. They say, "You want us to believe in you, Jesus. What sign are you going to give us so that we might see it and believe in you?" Now, this is the same crowd that experienced the feeding of the 5,000. Now they want Jesus to do something bigger and better, to wow them even more with some better miracle, some more dangerous miracle, some more miraculous miracle. "Give us a sign, Jesus, if you want us to believe in you." Basically, they wanted to be dazzled with bigger and bigger miracles. Now, if they aren't happy with that miracle, the implication is that, okay, Jesus, we're going to hit the buzzer. You are not going to make it into the next round of Israel has prophets and messiahs. You're going to be buzzed off the stage. They even mention a previous act that had gotten rave reviews, so much so that generations later, people were still talking about that incredible experience. They bring up the story that we read about in the Old Testament. They bring up what Moses did in the desert with their ancient ancestors when God provided them manna in the desert to sustain them on their quest for the promised land. And the crowd is even so bold as to quote this scripture from the Genesis passage I read back to Jesus. The crowd says to Jesus, "It's written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat." Mental note to self, don't try to quote scripture to Jesus to get what you want. It ain't gonna work. Jesus says, "You don't really understand. It wasn't Moses that gave you the bread. It wasn't Moses who gave our ancestors the bread. It was God who provided the bread. It was my Father who gave them the bread. Furthermore, you need to expand your view of daily bread. God provides daily bread, not just for you, not just for your ancient ancestors in the past, but God provides daily bread for everyone, for every living thing in the world today." Jesus says, "For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." Gives life to the world. I ran across a story of an interesting group. There's a group of Episcopalian women nuns in New York, in Brewster, New York. They are part of the Community of the Holy Spirit. That's the name of the group. And they have a farm there in Brewster, New York called Blue Stone Farm. And being a farm, the sisters often joke that their life is really all about food, because they raise a lot of food on that farm. But they have a very broad understanding of food. And I think it's a different view of food than what typically you and I might have. because it's so broad. Now, you're going to have to bear with me here because this is a group of Episcopalian nuns, and they use a lot of highfalutin language. But what they have to say, I think, is very important. This is what they say. The heart of our participation in the furtherance of the adventure of life is food. We understand that we arise from and are held within the arms of a Eucharistic universe. The Eucharist communion that we're going to be celebrating in just a little while, that's the Eucharist. And so these nuns are saying that this communion that we celebrate in the church, it's a sign and a symbol of greater things at work in the world, that we live in a Eucharistic universe. And here's what they mean by that. All energy exchange is costly. I'm going to be unpacking that a little bit more. All energy exchange is costly. They're inviting you to think of eating, regular eating, as an energy exchange, and here's what they mean by that. Individual life is given in part or in whole in order for other individuals to sustain life for a time. What these sisters are saying is that sacrifice is at the heart of the universe. Sacrifice is at the heart of the universe. Something has to be sacrificed in order for other things to live. This is a holy, sacrificial, and sacramental exchange that we honor and we celebrate, which is clearly reflected in our Christian heritage. Now, the sisters at Bluestone Farm pay attention to the cycles of life and death. They value human fellowship, and they observe with awe nature's self-sacrifice. And they contemplate the mystery of existence and life and becoming, demonstrated in everyday life. Now, I got to thinking a little bit about this passage and what the sisters had to say about this being a Eucharistic universe this morning. When I got up this morning, I had my raisin bran with sliced bananas on it. That's how I, what's what I had for breakfast, and a cup of hot tea. Now, the grain that went into making that cereal had to be harvested. Those plants and the grain plants had to give up their seed in order for me to eat that raisin bran. The raisins in there had to be harvested from the vineyards in California or wherever they are in order to for me to have the raisins in my raisin bran. The bananas came from the banana trees probably in Central America, and they had to be harvested in order for me to eat them this morning. And that raisin bran and bananas is sustaining me even as I speak to you now, as I have digested it and the calories are being taken up in my body and burned to make it possible for me to live this morning. The same with your breakfast and the breakfast that you had. The same for every meal that we ever have. That's how it works. It's an energy exchange that makes it possible for us to live. And on my way here, I was passing by the fields of corn that are ready to be harvested, and the sorghum that is being harvested in this area, even as we gather here today. Those plants receive the energy from the sun and from the rain and the soil and the work of those plants created the corn that we are going to eat and the sorghum that we will use for our cattle feed and to eat in some countries. The grain trucks were on their way to the elevator as I pulled into the parking lot this morning. That is an energy exchange, if you will, that makes it possible for us to live. And I read a fascinating article the other day about the energy that the sun showers the earth with. And I read an amazing statistic. The sun shining for just 1 hour provides more energy than the entire human race can use in a year. That's something to ponder. In 1 hour, the time that we are gathered in this worship service, the planet receives more energy than the entire human race could use in a year. Now, this is an amazing creation that God has created, and it's based on energy exchange to make life possible. And this is true in a physical sense. I would also suggest to you that it's true in a spiritual sense, that the Holy Spirit that animates this world also infuses our spiritual lives and brings us life eternal. Kingdom living makes possible right here and now in this world. In just a little while, in just moments, we are going to be celebrating the Eucharist, communion. We will take a little bit of bread growing in a farmer's field somewhere, probably here in the United States, harvested, trucked to a store, put on a store shelf by someone working at that store, checked out at the cashier's line as you go out the door. Same with the grape juice or the wine from a field in California with the sun and the rain pouring down on it, and someone harvesting it and again processing it and taking it to a store. It's not enough to keep our stomachs from grumbling when we have this little bit of bread and grape juice or wine. You're going to have to eat lunch when you leave here. But we trust and we believe that the bread and the cup are a sign of something far greater, a greater mystery, that this is a Eucharistic universe in which God sends manna from heaven and gives life with a capital L to the world. We admit that we don't fully understand this, that for all of our scientific achievements, it remains a mystery. We gather here to celebrate this mystery and to explore this mystery. And we all know and experience this in our own lives. Any of you who are parents know that to be a good parent requires self-sacrifice for that child. And all of us here hopefully had parents who realized that and made sacrifices for us to be the people that we are today. We live in a Eucharistic universe. We gather to celebrate that mystery. And we do so trusting that Christ is the bread of life, and that if we come to Christ, our hunger and thirst shall be assuaged. Amen. Well, today's communion liturgy I'm using was written by Reverend Tom Schumann, who's a Presbyterian minister, retired also, who does interim ministry up in the Great Lakes region, I think is where he's from. For those of you who are in our Zoom audience, I hope that you have a cup of whatever, grape juice, wine, or whatever is in your cup, along with some bread, so you can join us in the communion that we'll be celebrating shortly. Our greatest joy is to offer you our thanks and praise. Creator, grace giver, healer of our brokenness, all that is beautiful was created for our eyes. All that is wonderful was created for our awe. All that is majestic was created for our praise. All that is mystery was created for our silence. But despite everything you have given us, we are not satisfied. Believing life is about our appetites, we choose the moldy bread of the world. Knowing our only hope is from you, we continue to rebel. Called to live in unity with one another, we cling to all that divides us. And yet you refuse to let us go, sending your only Son, Jesus, to call us to life in you. We have fallen, and you lift us up. We have forsaken you, and you redeem us. We are broken, and you make us whole. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices here and now with the faithful of every time and place, singing to the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy are you, God of every mercy. All creation praises one God, Father, one Lord, one Spirit. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who gifts all of God's people. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, God of grace and tenderness, and blessed is Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Though we look for him in all the wrong places, he holds out the bread of life to us, and though we offer the cross to him, he graces us with life. Though we thirst for more and more, he offers us the cup of salvation. Though we gossip and slander one another, he speaks the truth in love to us. And though we would divide each other by class, race, or condition, he calls us to oneness in you, recalling your steadfast love in Christ, and knowing that we cannot understand your grace until that eternal day when we can know your heart. We take this bread and we take this cup, praising and blessing you for these gifts of hope and joy. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ died, seeming a prisoner of death. Christ was raised so that all might be freed in resurrection love. Christ will return, finishing the work of God. Holy God of truth, though we come to your table as many, may your Holy Spirit make us one body and one spirit. As you feed us with the bread of life, may we feed those who know true hunger. As your justice illuminates our heart's darkness, may we be a beacon to the oppressed and lost. As you speak to us the truth in love, may we be the voice for the powerless and the forgotten. And as you restore us to wholeness, may we bind up our shattered world. Through Christ who saved us, all glory and honor are yours. God, who created us in your own image, through the Holy Spirit and in your midst of making us your people, now and forever. Christ, on that last night, he took the bread and broke it, saying that this was his body broken for us. And likewise, he poured out the cup, saying, this is the cup of the new covenant in his blood for forgiveness of sins and fullness of life. In his name, I share with you now this bread and this cup as we partake together. O O Lord God, we give you thanks for refreshing us at this holy Eucharistic table, where we have shared in this morsel of bread and in this cup of salvation. We know, O Lord, that our stomachs will soon be empty, but our hearts and souls are full with the presence of your Holy Spirit. May it strengthen us for our journey and our walk in life, and may we carry Christ with us wherever we go. We pray this in his name. Amen. And let us stand for the closing song. Now, go in safety. You cannot go where God is not. Go with love, for love alone endures. Go with dedication, and God will honor your commitment. Go in peace, for peace is the gift to all those in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.